Chemical reactions all happen around us. When we light a matchstick, when we burn something, or when we respire, or when we eat something, when we dye anything, and so on. All these are examples of chemical reactions. Combination and decomposition are two basic kinds of chemical reactions that we have seen in the first part of this program. Today we are going to see an example of the displacement reaction between zinc and HCl. These are the zinc granules. In this reaction, zinc has displaced hydrogen from hydrogen chloride and formed zinc chloride. A gas is also evolved, that is hydrogen gas. Here are some kids dancing. One kid represents zinc, another pair represents hydrochloric acid. Observe them carefully. They are going to enact something like a chemical reaction. Now we'll see some more reactions. Here I am having magnesium metal, iron metal, gold and silver. This is hydrochloric acid. I'll put it into these four test tubes. Now I'm going to add magnesium metal into hydrochloric acid. We can see a vigorous reaction taking place here. Let us see what happens when iron is added into hydrochloric acid. Yes, the reaction has started here also. Is there any difference between the two? Let us observe more closely. The reaction with magnesium is much more vigorous than the reaction of iron with hydrochloric acid. This is a ring made up of silver. And this ring is made up of gold. I'm going to add these two to hydrochloric acid. Let us see what happens. Nothing seems to happen. These two metals are inert. They do not react with hydrochloric acid. But we can see that iron and magnesium, they reacted so fast. Gold does not react with acids, water, or even air. That is why gold is used for making jewelry. You must have relished pickles. Where do we store pickles? Pickles are stored either in a china clay or a ceramic, a glass, or a plastic container. But we do not store pickles in a metal container. Why so? Pickles, being acidic in nature, will react with metals, and that can be harmful for our body. This is hydrochloric acid. I'm going to add to each of these test tubes. This is magnesium I'm adding. This is aluminium, zinc, iron, tin, and copper. A vigorous reaction has started in magnesium. It is reacting very fast. Even the reaction in aluminium has started. Zinc has also started reacting, even iron. Tin is taking some time to react, and copper is not reacting. We can compare the reactivity of the metals here. Magnesium being the most reactive, copper is the least reactive. Aluminium, zinc, iron, and tin are lying in between. So this decreasing order of reactivity we can see over here. This orderly arrangement of reactivity of elements is known as the reactivity series. The reactivity series helps us to know whether the particular reaction will take place or not. For example, can we store copper sulfate solution in an aluminium vessel? Of course not. Aluminium is more reactive than copper. So, aluminium will displace copper from copper sulfate solution. Therefore, there is no question of keeping copper sulfate solution in aluminium vessel. From the reactivity series, now we know some elements are more reactive than others. And a more reactive element can displace a less reactive element from its salt solution. To test this, let us perform an experiment. This is ferrous sulfate salt. I'm going to prepare a solution of this in water. This is the salt of copper sulfate, and now we are going to prepare a solution of copper sulfate in water. Now to check the reactivity of different elements, I am going to add copper metal to ferrous sulfate solution. I am going to add zinc to copper sulfate solution. Let us observe what happens. What do you think should happen here? We can see some reaction starting up here.
This reaction can be explained with the help of chemical molecular models. This model represents copper sulfate molecule. Here, green colored ball represents copper atom, purple colored balls represent sulfur, and oxygen is represented by red colored balls. Here, zinc is represented by dark yellow colored ball. When zinc is added, it takes the place of copper, displacing it from its position.
Nothing is happening here. No chemical reaction is occurring. What could be the reason for this? Yes, of course. Copper being less reactive in nature is not able to displace iron from ferrous sulfate solution. We have seen few of the single displacement reactions. Let us go a step further, where we are going to observe double displacement reactions. Like a dandiya dance, even in a double displacement reaction, the partners can be exchanged. Here I am having lead nitrate. I am going to make a solution of this. This is a salt of potassium iodide. I'm going to prepare a solution of potassium iodide in water. Now I am going to mix these two solutions in the conical flask. Let us see what happens. We can see a bright yellow precipitate formed. So what has happened in this reaction? This is an example of double displacement reaction. And this precipitate that we can see will be slowly settling down. Observe carefully. Now I am going to do the same experiment on semi-micro scale. The product obtained here is lead iodide and potassium nitrate. The yellow precipitate that we can see is of lead iodide.
This model represents the molecule of lead nitrate. Black colored balls represent lead atom, blue colored balls nitrogen atom, and red colored balls represent oxygen atoms. This model represents potassium iodide. Orange colored balls represent potassium and yellow colored balls iodine. When these two solutions are mixed in the double displacement reaction, two iodine atoms from two molecules of potassium iodide replace two nitrate groups and a yellow precipitate of lead iodide is formed.
Now let us see some more examples of double displacement reactions. Here we have two setups. One is the reaction of lead acetate with potassium iodide, another one with ferrous sulfate and sodium hydroxide. Let me make the solutions. I'm going to make the solution of lead acetate in water. This is potassium iodide. I am going to make a solution of potassium iodide now. These solutions are ready. Now we are making a solution of ferrosulfate. For that we also need sulfuric acid. Then I'm going to make a solution of sodium hydroxide in water. So the solutions are ready. Let us mix them to see the actual reaction which is occurring. This is a displacement reaction with lead acetate and potassium iodide. Observe carefully what happens. What a wonderful precipitate has come up. Let us see another experiment. Yes, we can observe the green colored precipitate coming out from the colorless solutions. Does this mean a displacement reaction always forms precipitates, and that too colored? Of course not. Let us verify doing another experiment. Here we have two beakers. This is salt of sodium chloride. I'm going to make a solution of sodium chloride with water. The solution is ready. This is salt of magnesium sulfate. And now I'll prepare the solution of magnesium sulfate with water. Both the solutions are ready. We can see both the solutions are colorless. Let us mix both these solutions. the mixed solution is again colorless. Has the reaction occurred? Yes, the reaction has occurred, but both the products which are formed are colorless, so they are not visible. Something similar to this happens in our stomach also. If we have excess acid in our stomach, what do? We just take an antacid, which is nothing but a base. This base will combine with the excess acid in our body and neutralize it. So a similar neutralization reaction occurs in our body that will neutralize the excess acid, and hence we will be relieved of the burning sensation. What happens when a wasp stings someone? We apply a solution of vinegar. The wasp stings are alkaline in nature. Therefore, the acid neutralizes it and we are relieved of that pain. Similarly, when bees sting someone, we apply a bicarbonate solution, because the bees sting are acidic in nature, which are neutralized by applying a bicarbonate solution. Whenever you see a chemical reaction, think whether it is a single displacement reaction, a double displacement reaction, or a neutralization reaction.